I'm on.
Are we on? Are we on here?
Yes, we
are. Someone should be talking.
We're on.
Oh, Mac. We're back. And I'm on the ads. Yes, we're back.
I just had to check that out.
For all those people who tuned in a number of times throughout the few months, Steve has always mentioned that Frank Porter is always the one who steps up when we need somebody, and we needed somebody today because Exit 22 canceled today. I guess it must be because of the bad of the good weather. They must have canceled, but they canceled when you showed up. Thank you again.
I came straight from a guitar lesson. Excuse me, so I wasn't there just before I came here.
I was going to ask you something about that. Not all of the musicians can do that, obviously, because there'd be a glut. But there's been a lot of guitar players, piano players, vocalists that do teaching as well to supplement, as well as just keep in the field.
Yeah, I have a couple of great students.
When you consider your performance and your teaching, what percentage of teaching do you actually think you do?
That probably falls in somewhere around 70%.
That's not bad though. That's no, that's
it's pretty good.
Yeah,
it's
that's
pretty
nice.
Busy. They're steady students, and there's two of them.
Very cool.
And they have a goal. They have a very specific goal. I'm having them work towards that goal. And hopefully, once we get past that, they'll still be my students. I'm waiting to see how that all works out.
But they came to learn how to play guitar instead of
they were
came
leaders.
To learn how to play.
Yes.
A certain type of
a certain song specifically for a certain event. Just one song. And it's taken a while, but they were beginners, literally beginners. I mean, their fingers hurt. They had to develop strength in their hands to push down on the string, and they could walk down and give them an exercise in that they worked with.
And if they keep coming back, that's neat.
Yeah. They've been doing it for over a year, so two guys. And they're just little guys, 12 and 14 or something.
Wow. So they'll be slashing at 16 and 18.
We'll see.
Yeah.
They're starting to show some promise. And they came out to see me at Steel Stacks, which was awesome. So that was cool. Shout out to the Kane boys.
Well, along with your performing and teaching, excuse me, I talked to you before, but I did see a post that you're going to team up with Jane Supra.
Yes, this is happening.
Which I think is pretty darn cool.
It's almost like a storm has come into my life. Yeah. And we haven't even rehearsed once, and he keeps calling me up and saying stuff like, there's a date here. I think one of them will do that. Burnside Blueberry Festival.
Okay.
I think his band wasn't available for one day, so he somehow squeezed in the Porter Super Duo for the other day.
Very cool. Very cool.
I've been to that event. It's a nice event.
And if anything, you're going to learn something from each other because
who knows
you haven't
done
anything together,
go.
So it's really cool.
This is a very interesting opportunity. I feel very fortunate to have this happen. And who knows? Who knows where it's going to go musically?
Yeah.
Once the two of us get together and start working together.
Well, one thing I do know is that as far as I'm concerned, there's not a type of music that he can't play.
Yeah, I would agree.
You know, I mean, not every musician can play every type of music out there, but as a harmonica player, he's pretty darn close.
He's very versatile.
So when he comes up with a country song, I'm like, are you kidding? And then he pulls it off, and I'm going, well, then there you go.
Yeah.
Right, there you go. You can do that too.
Yes.
You know? But it just makes it, it'll make it a very interesting run.
It will. It should be a lot of fun. All I can say about that, at the very least, I'm sure it's going to be a lot of fun.
Yeah. Well, I'll keep us posted.
Oh, yeah.
Because I saw it this morning, so I'm going to keep looking. I clicked ban on Reverb Nation for you, so you got at least one fan. So, what would you like to regale us with to start?
I do have something that I want to send out in honor of Chuck Berry. It's something that I've been performing since I was probably 15 years old, or maybe 14, even. Somewhere around then, I picked up this song. And I remember at one point, I was in a garage in Winter, late Placid Mead, right, that had no heat. And a guest musician, one of the superstars in the area, Andrew Moore, came to hang out with us for the day and jam with us. And we were all excited because it's Andy Moore, he's really playing with us. And he goes, let's do Johnny Begins. And who knows the intro? And I rattle it off. So he's like, okay, you got the intro. I still remember that moment. And I was like, oh, I was very, now I'm scared because now I have to do
right, that. Right, right. Well, here he is.
Yeah.
Frank Porter with Johnny Be Good.
People don't even recognize talent sometimes. And I've noticed this. when I'm out either playing or watching someone play, some people don't recognize how very, very talented some people are.
It's, a lot of people take it for granted because they're out there, they're performing, you know, that kind of thing.
Right. I've heard that before. But you know, it's not really easy to duplicate some of these things. I don't think they really realize how much hard work goes into duplicating stuff. I've been doing a tune called Roy's Boogie for a long, long time. Also, because of my father, I thank him. He pushed me towards one of the harder songs on guitar right out of the gate. And maybe that would have discouraged a lot of people. But I took it as a challenge and I really went over it. And to this day, I'm still performing Roy's Boogie. And it really gave me a lot of skills that I otherwise probably wouldn't have found that quickly.
Right, yeah, you started on page 15 of the book instead of page 1.
Yeah, it was pretty cool, and I thank you guys. Rest in peace, man.
My wife always has a question. Well, she's brought this up a number of times, but I'll pose it to you. If you had a choice of sitting down with any musician with a cup of coffee, alive or dead, who would that be? Which is exactly what I tell them no. And then all these names pop up. But like, what do you think?
Could I pick a year?
Nah, just, you know, somebody you just want you.
Let's go with Jimmy Page.
All right. There you go. There's not a wrong answer. That's you know, the obvious.
I love him, and he can play slide. I need to learn how to play slide better, so I hung out with him.
Because when Chris asked me the first time, I had to have him on. Okay, John Lennon. You can't beat John Lennon. But then I started thinking, oh, well, then there's John Lennon. Could I have a group? Really? Yeah.
Amazing guitar.
Well, let's hear Roy's Boogie. All right, Frank Porter.
All right, I'm going to release this on an album in the very near future. I'm going to call it Frank's Boogie because I've taken it over.
Frank Porter.
I'm going to do another instrumental in that case. I don't get to do this one very often. It's not going to be on my next album, but it is a song that I once upon a time, in around 1999, sent to a lady in Los Angeles. She asked for more material, but I was so bummed she didn't bite on this one. I never sent her more material. So, oops on that one. Anyways, this thing, which obviously got her interested, is called Enchantment. It's a fairly long instrumental piece. It builds in momentum. It'll end. I'll be sweating by the end. Let's go back.
Oh yes, I see little beads of sweat on the brow.
Thank you.
We had a question from Paul Rosa, who's our videographer today. And it's a good question when you think about it. I'm sure you have tons of them, but is there a song that's difficult for you to play that still is difficult to play every time you play it? That makes sense to you?
It does.
Not with one of them. I think that's probably why it is, because wow, he's really good, but that looks like it's really hard.
It's not easy. I originally wrote that on a 12-string, and if you can imagine trying to do that on a 12-string acoustic guitar, that's insane. It's a death to your hand or something.
Yeah.
As it is right now, I can feel my tendon is so inflamed right now. Like, ooh, what did you do to me? I don't usually do that song. That's one of the reasons it's not easy. It's as easy as on an electric guitar, but it goes less.
Oh, of course.
Acoustically, I've been doing some challenging things lately on acoustic guitar, and that's kind of my MO these days. I'm trying to let it all rip on an acoustic because, as my wife said, and I have to give her credit here, when you do your electric guitar stuff on an acoustic, it's more unique. And she's right. I can't argue with her. That's a good point. Although, when you do your electric stuff on your acoustic guitar, it kills your hands as well, and your arms and all this other stuff, and it is not nearly as easy. So it becomes a lot more work for me. Thank you. But I'm liking it, and it's working. And the more I see it working, the more I'm finding ways to keep going. One of the tricks I've already had to adapt to is tuning down a little bit so it doesn't hurt so much. And also I've been doing long shows, sometimes 4-hour shows, and it's a lot of singing as well, so tuning down helps save my voice a little bit.
But when you tune down for me, do you go to E flat?
Usually.
Okay, so
sometimes I go a little lower, but usually E flat.
Okay. Because I think in the same way, Sterling Cook does the same, tunes down to E flat so he can not stress his voice quite as much.
Well, the way it works, I hope that I have a instrumental sound. So between the instrumentals and tuning down, I can get through a 4-hour show still. I think that's pretty impressive.
Well, that's because you didn't stay up until 4 o'clock in the morning partying. That's why you get through a 4-hour show.
Yeah, I can't do that anymore.
Well, let's see. I think we have another couple songs, and then Leon and I are here if you want to have a drink. Because now that I know you're in E-flat, I can play with E-flat.
Alright, yeah, I have one that I would like to do actually. I don't know if I'm going to remember all the words and words I brought the lyrics, but the story on this is as I prepare for the Steel Stack show, I had been performing a song called Nitro that a friend who's now passed away, Ellie Carroll, that's a huge beautiful lady, beautiful voice, wrote the words to it. She was a heroin addict at one point. She got clean. She was clean for 18 to 19 years. And, but this song illustrates how powerful heroin is, because it was still calling to her. And she told me that, and the song tells us that, and we hear the words, these are her words. It's still calling her after 18 years it was still, not something that she could just have a nice peaceful life. It was like feeling for her. So this song is very relevant to what's going on now, even though it is probably on the base of 1994. The music was written in 1980, which is really crazy. That's why I first wrote the music to Metro. The drummer's mom goes, "What is that? I like that."
Yeah.
I was not thinking that was so cool at the time. I was like, my drummer's mom likes it?
It can't be good if she likes it,
That can't be great. That's how I was feeling. So, here we go. This is
all right. Thank you.
Thank you.
Clark, very special friend.
Thank you.
Yeah, always. It's always a pleasure having you come back here. And
I feel like part of the family. I really do.
You are. You know, it's
kind of like the fans back together when I show up.
Yeah. I'm always reminded of the sign from up in Lake Placid, but you know. One day we have more time. What we're going to do is we're going to do a book. It's going to be called The Memoirs of Frank Porter. And then we're going to talk about all the different crazy stories that you have. Matter of fact, what we're going to do, I got this great idea. Okay. We're going to do like a TV series of Frank Porter. It's going to be like Once Upon a Time.
I have enough stories to
exactly.
Go through years. Yeah.
We can go through like years of all these different stories. And oh, you know, I mean, the coolest one is when you throw in the shopping cart over the fence. I just think that is so cool.
Who would do that for real? And we did it for real. That's the funny thing.
I didn't get kicked out.
Push a shopping cart full of music gear in 9 months.
Well, yeah.
Me and Pierre.
All right, hang on.
I need to get Pierre out here. This is what I need to get. He's out in California today.
All right, check that call.
Yeah.
And you got a quarter to sit down there for his bass. I'll give you power on that right away. What's up?
There was another character up there in the Adirondacks, Roy Kennedy. He was a college-educated guy, and this is my one Roy Kennedy story, the one that's kind of weird. I had OD'd on my asthma medication, and I was hallucinating really bad, and he got wind of what I had eaten.
Got wind?
Yeah. Yeah, he showed up just like out of the blue, like he was sent there for an angel almost. And what he had been doing is mountain hopping and gathering belladonna. And he had turned it into some belladonna powder, which he mixed with some water, gave it to me. And I was out for over 24 hours. And when I came to, there was a vigil around my bed. And the first thing I did, I saw a bottle of wine in someone's hand. I was kind of thirsty. I go, wine? So I drank wine, and then we started rehearsing.
My younger brother has a story he likes to tell occasionally. I think it's you guys that like go west and slightly north. He was at college, and it was Halloween,
right.
And he dresses himself up as the Incredible Melting Man, and he's dancing with a gal that's dressed like Lil Bo Peep, and she passes out from drinking.
Ooh. No, sure, that old song.
Yeah, I wouldn't believe that. But so anyway, he gets fed up. And they do the judging. Some guy in a frog outfit, so he gets upset and goes back to his room. And because he drank a lot, he had a moment, but he didn't know that his garbage can that he used was a wicker garbage can, and he kind of leaked out. So here he is. He's the Incredible Melting Man. Has this slow gin that's red, and it's a wicker garbage can, and it's all. People walked in the room, they thought he died. So, on Halloween. So there's a lot of screaming going on until he woke up.
That's a creepy kind of story, actually.
My brother's a good for stories. So that's probably why you fit in as part of the family, because of the stories. A little quick introduction here. What we're forming up here is the Acoustic Blues Project.
Which fortunately is a project, because we always seem to have another guitar player, which is really cool.
This is Earl's main project that we put together, but we also have Tom Cooney in the Gutton in Phoenix right now.
Making buku bucks.
Okay. Does that have George Washington's picture on the one?
Oh, no.
No. Not George Washington. Does it have Art Lee that was on the one?
Going like this.
Yeah, something like that. Anyway, then Tom Cooney, he's usually their lead guitarist, and Leon Bonham. What'd you do?
That's a strange habit.
That's a long story.
I have to switch guitars at this
point. Wait. Go ahead. I haven't popped the speakers yet, and I'm doing pretty good. You plug in? Frank, plug in. Yeah.
You're awesome.
You must learn the technology.
Okay, I'll let Earl take it from here.
So what key are we doing our... What are we doing? That's the fun part about it.
Beethoven's fifth.
We have notes away.
Turn it on.
Oh, it's an old microphone.
Oh, God. I don't own a single microphone in the world on the Switch.
So
it's only ones I buy. I like it with switches on. They say they're not as good. I happen to like mics with switches because you control what you're talking. When you're talking, you can shut yourself out of the circuit so you don't talk on the mic. That's why I like.
That's why I keep the mixer board next to me, and it's got individual channel mutes. So I just reach
around. Well, yeah, that works for you. Okay, but when I'm walking around back and forth, I'm always tuning myself in and out. Okay, anyway, no.
Okay, let's start with one in the people's key of A.
Hey!
As we do Great White North thing.
Earl, take it right.
Okay.
Don't love me, she loved my automobile. She don't love me, she loved my automobile. She do anything just to slide behind the wheel. She say, what's it gonna take for you to lay your cap on down? She say, what's it gonna take for you? Lay your top on down. Well, I don't know, honey. Discuss it when we get to the outskirts of town. Cause she don't love me, she love my automobile. She don't love me, she love my automobile. She do anything just to slide behind the wheel. Take two, Frank. Stoned or slapping drunk. She don't care if I'm stoned or slapping drunk. Long as there's gas in the tank and a good family trunk. Cause she don't love me, she love my automobile. She don't love me, she loved my automobile. She do anything just to slide behind the wheel. Earl. She don't love me, she
She loved my automobile. She don't love me. She loved my automobile. She do anything just to slide behind the wheel.
Yes.
She don't love me. 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 She loved my automobile.
Thank you. Thank you, Brent. Thank you, Brent.
Oh, let's see here. Let's.
Low and slow in G. Yeah, we're gonna do a piece of direct that I wrote.
Dark.
be somewhere on a log.
You're looking better.
move and she can really shake that thing, Ramona. Why you look so good?
Some entertainment for tonight and fill in the night. So thank you very much out to Michael Dorn and all of Engine 22. We look forward to having you on the show in the future. So again, moving right forward here, you know, what it was, a little music here. We're gonna have just a little bit of fun. So this completes this segment of Rockin' the Valley. Tonight, meet the bands. I'm Stephen Fisher. Or it's here, right? I don't know what you want to do. But anyway, Stephen Fisher here for Rockin' Out here live at Jeff Wharton 400. Airport Road at the Dates Hotel. Stop on that here for some great food, Stromboli, all kinds of good things. Thank you very much to the Jetport staff. Paul Rosa on our cameraman, Earl Andrews, Beth Ellen, and all the Rockin' Valley staff. Thank you very much for tuning in. Stay tuned for After Hours with Dancy James coming up in about 25 minutes. Right now, we're going to pay some tribute to the father of rock and roll, as I like to call him, or the grandfather, Chuck Berry, who just recently passed away. Man was a legend. I remember seeing a video of him with the Boss, Bruce Springsteen, standing back and letting the man do his famous stuff well. So we're going to listen to some Chuck Berry music and some Beach Boys music that Chuck Berry was responsible for writing. So stick with us here, Stephen Christopher, with Rockin' the Valley, Lehigh Valley's number one internet broadcast station. Thank you very much.